to eating behavior. Well, I think the link is this. It's been known for a long time that there are certain behaviors that are innate, and that is hardwired. So behaviors that are there to defend against survival. So reproductive behaviors, behaviors that allow you to protect your offspring, but also eating would make sense as being a behavior that's highly encoded in the brain, because of course it is fundamental for survival. And I think this is important for two reasons. Firstly, when we see patients, the link between eating behavior, mood, and other types of behavioral disorders may have its underpinnings in these kinds of circuits. But also it allows us to think about obesity as, if you like, a faulty mechanism that was originally there to allow us to defend against famine or starvation. And really this is my simplistic view of that, that the hypothalamus links with behavior through the effects on hormones and affect reproduction of the thyroid axis, and through effects on the autonomic nervous system can affect blood pressure, cardiovascular tone, and the gut. And essentially, by studying these patients, we think we've unpicked a lot of these pathways and circuits. But the challenge really now for all of us is to work out how this is relevant to more common forms of obesity, which is likely to be some form of dysregulation of these same pathways. And just really a couple of final notes, which was that whilst we found a number of genes in this pathway, new things are coming up all the time. Interestingly, the genes that we found to date in this leptin melanocortin pathway cause obesity in only 10% of our cohort. So we think that because the rest of the children are as severely obese, there's still a great deal more to find. We're doing exome sequencing and using a number of different tools to try to get at this information. One way that we can try and pick off genes that may be the most reasonable to look at is genes, again, that cause obesity in mice. And here's just one example of that, KSR2, which is a scaffolding protein involved in this signaling pathway, where we find a number of mutations. It's important because here we see the patients, as well as an increase in food intake, for the first time, they also have a low metabolic rate. So these patients do not have hypothyroidism, but actually in many ways behave just like hypothyroid people. They have a low metabolic rate. And in cells, they have impaired glucose oxidation and fatty acid oxidation. They can't burn fat as well. So this really links to a phenotype that we've seen in a number of patients and we're beginning to find the mechanisms for, where when people try to lose weight or their calories are restricted, they can't burn the fat as well as others. And there are mechanisms underpinning. And this is just a slide to remind me about this young patient who has the KSR2 mutation. And as you can see, you know, he doesn't necessarily look that big. In fact, he has found that exercise allows him to maintain his weight. And that's quite unusual because with the other genes, the leptin MC4 pathway, exercise is really pretty ineffective. Mainly because you need that pathway to cause weight loss in response to exercise. So if the pathway is not working, even if you really exercise, it's very hard to lose weight. These patients find that they're very responsive to the effects of exercise. Many of them actively engage in exercise, in fact, didn't particularly want to come and see me because they're not so worried about their weight anymore. These patients also respond to another drug, and that's metformin. Some of them were given metformin as a clinical drug, so empirically, because they have severe insulin resistance, and found they lost a lot of weight with metformin, much more than we'd expect, and much more than we commonly see. And probably the reason for this is that metformin is specifically doing something to KSR2 in cells by interacting with AMP kinase. We can show that in cells where there's a defect in how the cells burn fat, and that defect is corrected when you add metformin to the cells. So really just to give you a flavor of the fact that some of the things that we observe clinically may have very real biological explanations. And really just to finish this part is I just wanted to mention that I think it's pretty important that finding these genes has value to the patients. We've set up a diagnostic test which allows us to test all the known genes for human obesity in a single panel. We can do this for colleagues around the world and do so, but also ask people to engage with our research. And I think it's important for the patients really to give them an explanation of what's going on. It can help to challenge some of the stigma with severe obesity and also allow them to access appropriate clinical support. So really for the final few slides, I just wanted to mention how we're thinking about future perspectives and future things that we're trying to do. For us, trying to find these genes is a way of trying to map out the pathways that regulate weight and see how we might target them for therapies. So we're building up a picture that there are peripheral signals that I've mentioned that feed into the brain defend against starvation and are there to kick in to restore energy balance. When you get into the hypothalamus, we're now beginning to see from animal studies that there are sets of neuronal populations that are connected. This is just my map of how some of these pathways are emerging. And what we can see is if we strip that map out and narrowed along the genes which are disrupted in human obesity, we're beginning to see that some of those genes and some of those pathways may be more important than others in humans. But also, if we map on some of the genes that we're currently working on, you see we're beginning now to populate this map in more detail. And there appear to be two key nodes in the brain where these signals are integrated. So firstly is in the arcuate nucleus, the POMC neurons, which respond to the peripheral signals such as leptin. And secondly, the MC4R expressing neurons that these connect to. And these appear to be key nodes for the regulation of human appetite. We can then see that a lot of the genes that we found, picking them off one by one, are now actually working in those same places. They come together on the same neuronal populations shown in this schematic. And essentially, what we need to do is to work out what is happening at the neuronal level. Now, that's always been a bit of a challenge in humans and the human brain, but now that the technologies are emerging, we can use new ways of studying neurons. So we've recently recruited Florian Merkel from Harvard to work with us in Cambridge, and Florian has set up a tool for taking stem cells and making them into neurons, indeed making them into hypothalamic neurons. So you can take stem cells from a patient with a genetic mutation, and you would have in a dish hypothalamic neurons that carry that mutation, so you could then study what is the defect and what can you do about it. We're also very excited about the fact that we may be able to target this pathway, because clearly that's a long-term aim of ours. We're working with Rhythm Pharmaceuticals, who've got a melanocortin 4 receptor agonist, which again you'll hear more about in this meeting, and there's a poster on Friday I'd encourage you to attend and see. But essentially this is a compound that acts on the melanocortin 4 receptor and seems in animals to result in weight loss, but without changing blood pressure. We can show in cells that this compound rescues defective MC4R mutations, so it can increase signaling through this pathway, that patients in phase 1 trial of this compound lose weight very nicely, and the most dramatic effects were seen in studies by Peter Kuhnen and Heiko Kuhle in Berlin, where patients who have a complete loss of signaling of this pathway with a lack of POMC dramatically lose weight when given seven. And really, just a final perspective is one of the ways to think about obesity is actually to sometimes break outside of a box and think about the different ways of tackling something. And here we've been thinking for a long time about the influences on the regulation of weight and the fact that genes influence weight across the spectrum. Of course, we focused so far on severe obesity, and we know there are a number of genes that are driving severe obesity. But actually, the epidemiological data shows that thinness is also highly heritable. Now, purely for philosophical reasons, I've not really wanted to study thinness for a long time. But maybe there's a reason why some people can defend a lower body weight in an obesogenic environment. And wouldn't it be interesting to try to find out how some people can remain thin in an obesogenic environment? In fact, there's good animal evidence that there are genes that encode for leanness, and there are also genes that prevent animals from gaining weight when challenged with a high-fat diet. And we were really interested to try and find the human equivalent of those genes and those pathways. So how should we try and do that? Well, we need people to volunteer. We're very fortunate in the UK that our National Health Service allows us to recruit people from general practice. And we've now recruited a cohort of over 2,000 people who are thin, but well. So this is not anorexia nervosa. This is people who are thin, do not have any other medical conditions, do not have an eating disorder, but are well. And what we're trying to do really is to undertake some genetic studies in that cohort to see if we can find genes that are protecting them from obesity or causing thinness. Interestingly, so far what we find is that the common variants for obesity are reduced. So they have less of a burden of genetic obesity susceptibility alleles, as you might expect, genetically encoding for thinness. And we're also interested in trying to understand the phenotypes of these individuals. Because again, like with obesity, spectrum of phenotypes. There are people who are not interested in eating, and there are also people who can eat what they like and they don't want to weight. Probably all know those people, always envy them, in fact. But I think I'd be really intrigued to try and work out what's going on. Okay, so really just want to finish by saying that I hope I've shown you some examples of how we found rare, highly penetrant genetic variants, melanocortin pathway plays a pivotal role in regulating weight, and it's really there in all of us to defend against starvation. It kicks in if you're dieting or starving or undergoing weight loss, but that's why we have this system, to defend against starvation. The challenge really, and we still don't know this, is what happens to this pathway in common obesity. There's some evidence from animal models that animals become resistant to the effects of leptin, or this